Good afternoon, everyone. Please take your seat. Thank you. Hello, everyone. I'm Maggie Oriente, Director of Development and Communications for the American Humanist Association and this year's conference coordinator.
Thank you.
How's everyone enjoying the conference so far? All right, great. And you know why it's going so smoothly, right? It's because I prayed to the flying spaghetti monster. I said, oh, blessed be his noodly appendage. Please make sure that there are no problems at this conference in your holy name, Ramen. And I think it's working so far, so don't mess it up. No, but in all seriousness, I'd really like to take this opportunity to thank our amazing AHA staff, the volunteers from the Humanist Association of Greater Philadelphia, and the hotel and AV staff. They've been doing such a great job. Let's give them a round of applause. Yeah. They make me look good. So some of you know that I came to work for the American Humanist Association immediately after college. I was a closet atheist for most of my life, and I remember entering my freshman year at James Madison University in Harrisonburg, Virginia. JMU! All right. And of course, I go on campus and I'm thinking, I have got to be the only atheist on this entire campus. And I was so happy to discover that that wasn't true. There was a group called the JMU Freethinkers that formed, and I joined it, and I finally found my community and my calling, if you will, to work for atheist and humanist activism. And in fact, some of you may know this. There was a First Reason rally called the Godless Americans March on Washington, D.C. in 2002. Who was there? Yeah, all right. Awesome. I was there, too. I came with my Freethinkers crew, and we all wore the same t-shirt. You remember the Got Milk ads, right? Well, our t-shirt said, Got Jesus? Nope. And that picture appeared on websites and blogs and things, and I said, oh man, I'm an out atheist humanist now. So while I was in college and causing all kinds of trouble, I went to a Secular Student Alliance conference, and I met Mel Lippman, who was president of the AHA at the time, and he offered me an internship, and then I got hired full-time. And so this is my 9th year working for the AHA. And thank you. And it's a great honor to work for such a long-standing, respected organization. I've been truly inspired by the incredible people I've been able to meet at our annual conferences. My favorite, in 2010, not only did I get to meet our Humanist of the Year, Bill Nye the Science Guy, but I got to have a beer with him after the conference. He drinks Fat Tire, by the way. And he was explaining to me what a slide rule was. I'm sorry, I didn't know what a slide rule was. But I've got Bill Nye explaining this to me. Bill Nye! I mean, it's amazing. And he was, you know, we're just chatting, we're having a beer, he's sitting next to me, he's wearing his bow tie, shooting the shit, it's awesome. Oh, God, I'm sorry. Okay, Flying Spaghetti Monster, I prayed that I would not say a bad word during my speech. Sorry for all of you live streaming, this is a family-friendly event, okay? Okay. And then last night, I, along with many of you, got to hear Barney Frank in his inspiring speech. In the video where he's speaking so passionately on the House floor in defense of ENDA, he talked about using his position to help people. To help the 15-year-old who's afraid to go to school for fear of bullying. To help the business owner who's afraid of losing her job. And I think that's what I and a lot of us in this room strive to do every day. To help people. To help young people. To make it easier for everyone to come out as an atheist or a humanist without judgment. And to stand up against injustice wherever it may be. And so I'm going to use my position here on stage to introduce a student who's doing that right now. Now, high school is bad enough, right, as many of you know. And so it's very hard for atheists and humanists to come out and be public about their beliefs. So when one is willing to go public, knowing that he or she will face adversity, that takes courage. This high school student did just that in Fayette, Missouri. I don't know. With help from the American Humanist Association, he filed a lawsuit against school officials after his teacher led weekly Christian devotional prayer sessions during school hours. His article on thehumanist.com entitled "Why I Sued Fayette High School" was the most clicked on article that week with thousands of views. One reader left the following comment on his article stating, "Your bravery is what gives me hope for the future." He's also a self-proclaimed artist and hopes to be a civil rights attorney and politician, so definitely get his autograph before you leave. Please welcome to the stage Gavin Hunt.
Hello, my name is Gavin Hunt. I rode Amtrak from East Peoria, Illinois, to attend this event and share my story with people who hold similar beliefs. I recently filed a lawsuit with the AHA against my former school for promoting Christianity. I knew that the practices they carried out were illegal, but at the time, wasn't aware of what I could do. During my time in Missouri, I became affiliated with many freethought forums, message boards, and groups as a means of expressing myself. I was attacked for my lack of belief in the Christian God on numerous occasions. I was threatened for not sharing the same beliefs, as I'm sure many others have been. I couldn't allow myself or others to be contemned with this, so I sought legal action. I came across the AHA website. I noticed a small blue rectangle with white text which read, "Report a violation," and led me to an area that explained why I might be interested. I filled in the report, telling my story, but never expected anything back or for it to have gone this far. The Westboro Baptist Church even protested the case, and that right there is a dream come true. On Fridays, the principal would loudly announce that Friday morning devotionals were being held in the teacher's room. This was announced every Friday morning, even though everyone knew that it took place in her room and that it would continue to. The endorsement of Christianity didn't stop there. The teacher would interrupt lectures with stories of her past, continuously referencing to her dogma, and telling students to have a blessed day. She even saw fit to prominently place religious literature upon her desk. When the school received the letter in the beginning regarding the religious environment, she placed the book backwards instead of removing it, completely denying the possibility that they were in the wrong. The flyer depicted a Christian crucifix and the religious phrase, "Many hands make for light work." I couldn't help but notice the Christian environment which was created there. Many students and teachers have reached out to me to thank me for what I've done. People who would have otherwise lost their jobs for doing what is legal and right. People who have been alienated by their communities. People who would have otherwise been too fearful of speaking out against the school's conduct. These are ordinary, law-abiding citizens being alienated by their communities because they do not happen to have the same beliefs. I don't feel that is right, nor will I ever. I plan to make it my life's goal to fight cases like this and others involving civil rights. There have been those who agreed with me and those who haven't. What everyone has failed to realize is the importance of this case and many others like it. Science classrooms are being invaded by religious teachings. Teachers are using their authority to operate as preachers. Students are being alienated based on their beliefs, and most of all, our future is being corrupted by a righteous ideology that only impedes human progress. America will not consist of scientists, engineers, and leaders looking for innovative ways to solve problems, but instead it will consist of those bowing their heads and waiting for someone else to, or pretending that the problems don't exist. I'd like to conclude my speech by thanking the AHA for cooperating with me for the greater good. I appreciate those of you who took the time to come here and listen. Thank you.
Wow. Wow. Thank you so much, Gavin. Thank you so much. And thank you. We have students here. Where's the student contingent? Where are you guys? They're not here? Oh, they're partying at the bar. I know. Okay. We've got Tani here. It's cool. No, it's great. I'm so inspired by students. I'm so inspired by you guys who are really down there and doing such great work and being out and open about your atheism and really, really fighting and standing up for your rights. I'd also love to give a shout out to some folks who came from across the pond, the International Humanist and Ethical Union. Where are you guys? Wave. Hi, you guys. Woo! They came from Norway, Britain, the Netherlands, Belgium. Welcome to America. Yay. No, thank you so much for coming, you guys. We're so excited to have you. To introduce the recipient of the 2014 Humanist Business Leader Award, I'd like to welcome the Executive Director of the American Humanist Association. He's appeared on Good Morning America, CNN Headline News, and Fox News multiple times. He's been called a cannibal by Catholic League President Bill Donahue. He's been called the head humanist by Bill O'Reilly. And recently, former host of The View, Elizabeth Hasselbeck, told Roy on live television, "I love you." Now, as his spouse, I think I can take her. Please welcome Roy Speckhart.
Steve Rade is a leader in business, a philanthropist, and a humanist. And he's got that sharp, no-nonsense attitude and a business sense that immediately recognizes the real. And that I admire him for. During the 1980s, he rose to prominence in the telecommunications business, founding Advanced Videotech Corp in 1982, an importer of two-way radios. Then in 1984, he founded Advanced Cellular Systems and became the leading agent of Comcast Metaphone, Philadelphia's first airtime carrier. Finally, with his wife, Susan, who's here to do, Steve founded Wireless Accessories Group in 1988, a nationwide distributor of phone accessories with which Steve remains chief operating officer. Steve Rade became active in secular humanism almost 20 years ago when he helped organize the Philadelphia Association for Critical Thinking, FACT, as its acronym is pronounced. And it's still growing strong as a skeptic group that faces fiction with facts. Steve was also involved in supporting the Center for Inquiry and other nonprofit endeavors for some time, but a breakthrough occurred in 2008 when he organized local leaders here in Philadelphia to form PhillyCorps, a coalition effort to connect and strengthen local free thought, humanist, atheist, agnostic, and rational groups. Well, that effort drew international press attention and a steady stream of publicity surrounding in all this area. And Steve realized that this sort of effort was needed across the nation. So, as he'll tell you more about, he helped found the United Coalition of Reason and arranged to have its management done through the American Humanist Association. And now, with its affiliates in 70 media markets around the country, United Coalition of Reason is supporting local groups in the community of reason to cooperate toward achieving visibility, membership, and impact in cities, counties, and states across the country and even in Canada. Because bringing groups in our movement together has been one of Steve's abiding passions, he became an eager supporter of the major unifying event of our movement, held March 24th in 2012 on the National Mall in Washington, D.C. Yes, the Reason Rally. Not only did he provide financial backing allowing United Corps to be one of the major sponsors, but he also put up additional funds to help us bus people from all around to come to this event and make it the big event that it was. Through all the things he's doing, it's because of Steve Rade that our movement is becoming more cooperative than ever before. Moreover, Steve Rade is one of only four supporters in the history of the American Humanist Association, and among very few for organizations movement-wide, who is in the $1 million club for his lifetime support. Thank you. Thank you for your generosity, for your leadership and vision, and for sparking the meaningful change for humanists everywhere. Thank you.
I say thank you, Roy, for those kind words, and let me compliment you for saying it exactly the way I wrote it out for you. Very nice. Just kidding. But actually, giving this honor is a way to get me to up my donations, so smart on your part. So I just have a few brief comments to share today with you. First, most important, I want to thank Fred Edwards, wherever you are out there. Fred is the executive director of United Core, and he's put in 5 years of dedication, inspiration, education in creating this group and making it what it is today, and I can't thank him enough for how great he's made it. Based on a recent meeting we had with our board of directors, Jan Michon, Roy Speckart, we've made plans to improve the services we offer to the locals by increasing our programs and making United Core stronger than it's ever been. So I'm looking forward to that. And I also want to compliment and thank Margaret Downey for she actually laid the groundwork for the thought process that went into creating United Core, so thank you, Margaret. And Joseph Stewart, I don't know if he's here today, he is our programmer. Where's Joseph? Hey, Joseph. We have an interactive website with all of our 70 coalitions, and totally, Joseph is the one who's created that. It's highly professional. Thank you so much. You know, back in 2008, 2009, some people wondered why the secular movement needs another group. I mean, we had the Center for Inquiry, we had the Council for Secular Humanism, we have the American Humanist Association, the American Atheists, we have the Freedom from Religion Foundation, Military Association of Atheists and Freethinkers, we have the Freethought Society, and many more. I would run out of time if I tried to name them all. So why did we need another organization here? Well, the answer to the question is that back in 2009, most of these groups didn't even know each other existed, and they didn't talk to each other. So they were like islands in an ocean, and they didn't work together, and there was no power and no strength. So, and one of the reasons we have so many groups out there is the fact that we as a movement call ourselves by so many different names. We call ourselves secularists and humanists and secular humanists, and we're skeptics, and we're non-believers, and we're free thinkers, we're atheists, we're agnostics, we're critical thinkers, we're ethical culturists, we're Unitarians, and my favorite one of all, the Brights. Love the Brights. Don't know how many are here, but I hope you're not offended. It's a great name. So with all this obvious fragmentation and different groups and the variety of identifying labels, the movement had no critical mass. There was no unified voice, and there was hardly any public awareness of who we were. So it became obvious to me that the way to get people together was to form local coalitions. So, you know, obviously coalitions have a louder voice than individual groups. there's obviously strength in numbers, and let's face it, coalitions have much more political clout. So I became passionate about building a coalition, and I still remain committed to this cause. Some of you may wonder how I got involved even in this secular community. And actually, the story is fairly simple. For many years, I was sort of like a silent donor to secular causes. I didn't take that much of an active role. In the mid-90s, I did start FACT, a local group that's still very active and has meetings every month. But basically, I wasn't taking a very active role the way I wanted to. And in 2009, I was a little over 70 years old, and that's not young by any standards. And I said if I want to make any difference in life, I better get busy and start to do something now. So what I did is I called AHA's Washington office, and I got the name of a local leader that they recommended that I talk to. And many of you might remember him. His name was Joe Fox. Joe is no longer with us, but he was one super guy who you couldn't help but love and was a major force in the local secular movement. At any rate, I got a hold of Joe, and he in turn introduced me and told me the names of all the local groups in the Delaware Valley and who the leaders were. And what I did with his help is we called them all, and we got them together up in Willow Grove near where I live, and I invited them all out to dinner at a Chinese restaurant. And 10 people show up, half of whom didn't even know each other, and we sat down and had a great dinner, and we started to talk about, why don't we get together? Why don't we make something big happen out of all this? And they said, well, let's think about this. And sure enough, a couple days later, they all agreed. And part of the bargain was that I would pay for a big billboard, and we would announce a coalition called Philly Corps. And they liked that idea. So about 2 months later, we were able to secure a 50-foot giant billboard on Route 95, just as you came onto the Delaware Expressway. It was a big sign leaving downtown. And we said, as a group, we would have a summer picnic, we would have a winter solstice party, we would work with maybe local churches to do some public works that were good, that would show us as being no different than anyone else. And this is how actually Philly Corps started. And of course, from there, it evolved into United Corps. So at that time, the Philadelphia Inquirer wrote a story when the billboard went up, and it made, you know, the papers in a very big way. And I happen to have two kids, two daughters. They live in Los Angeles, and we're very close. Talk to them almost every day, but I never told them what I had done. So after the article appeared in the Inquirer, my youngest daughter, Steffi, she calls me, you know, Dad, what's going on with you in Philly? Did you lose your mind putting up billboards? You know, and how much money did you spend? And how much of it was my future inheritance? I hope she was joking. But after I explained to her the whole story and reassured her that I might be a little strange, but I'm definitely not crazy, she felt good about the project and what we had planned for the future. So United Corps, for me, became a springboard for a whole bunch of new secular programs that I've become involved in. And it's let me become happily involved in so many other areas of secularism. And as Roy mentioned, I was proud to support the 2012 Reason Rally. And thanks to those of you in this room who braved that horrific rain all day, I was in a poncho myself to attend that event and to prove to the world that the secular community is no longer the silent minority that it once was. More recently, I've funded the lobby day that's going to be next week. Hope to see all of you in Washington, D.C. next week. So that's been some of the ways that I've been involved in secularism. And I thought today would be a good opportunity to put out some thoughts and some ideas that I have for combining new ways of growing our movement and also finding more people like myself who have money, who want to put it out there and donate it to our cause. So I think outreach is a very important fact, and we have to put some plans in place to counter this recent Supreme Court ruling and other decisions and the things that the religious right is doing to diminish our movement. And we need to make our voices heard in many ways. We need to be on the internet, on the radio, in print media. We need to educate a lot of people out there about what our movement is about. And I was thinking of one type of outreach. I don't know if you're aware that there's 15 million United States citizens that are of Asian descent. And I doubt whether in this room there's 10 people that are Indian, Chinese, Korean, or other Asian folks. And yet these are people with high educations, good finances, and would be a great way to expand our outreach. Because if you're a Buddhist or you're a Hindu, you don't want to see a Jesus cross or a religious statue on public grounds any more than we do. So I think we have allied goals that should be exploited and made an outreach for. And there are some groups that I want to acknowledge that have done some amazing things. And as I look around the room, there's the Recovering from Religion Foundation. They've developed a method of linking callers who are looking to escape from their former religious beliefs and hook up with volunteer phone counselors around the country. This is a technology that I supported, and thanks to Sarah Moorhead for coming up with that concept. American Atheist has a program to install benches in public spaces where there's a Jesus statue or some religious symbol. Also, American Atheist has just come out with a streaming TV channel, which is going to allow all groups within our movement to contribute content. You probably all know about the Freedom from Religion Foundation airing spot TV commercials featuring Ron Regan Jr. They came out a couple weeks ago on Memorial Day. And these are the kind of big ideas that need big funders, people that have some money that want to get behind these kinds of programs. And I think we need to find new people and to find new ways of money. The sources of money I'm thinking about are entrepreneurs, crowdfunding, and professional fundraisers. Let's start, for instance, with entrepreneurs. I'm getting an award for Business Person of the Year, and I think the word business person is a little bit generic. I look at myself as an entrepreneur. Entrepreneurs are people who want to build things. They want to see things happen. They want to know that there's a program that they can endorse and become a part of, that it has a beginning, a middle, and an end, and you can measure the progress. And I think going after more people like this, people that own small and mid-sized businesses, are perfect candidates for greater funding for our movement. And there's plenty of them out there. There's raising funds, as I said, through the interconnected internet world. Social media now is at our fingertips. And crowdfunding. Entrepreneurs use crowdfunding to get the world to support their ideas. We have ideas. We can use crowdfunding in the same way. It's something that maybe hasn't been done, but I think should be done. And then my last thought on this is possibly hiring a professional fundraiser. someone who goes out full-time, makes phone calls to these wealthier people, who makes visits, creates relationships, and gets folks to sustain their giving over a period of time. I think having that kind of person and possibly splitting the cost of a high-level person among all the major organizations in our movement would make it affordable, and it would have a much bigger benefit because everyone would have a stake in the result of this fundraiser. And, you know, we all get requests every day in the mail. I call it junk mail. Most of it we throw away. It doesn't really raise the big money needed to move this movement forward in the way it needs to be moved forward. So I realize a lot of these ideas have probably not been tried before, but, you know, 5 years ago, United Corps hadn't been tried before, and now it's a reality. So I think trying it will produce a great result. And as a final thought, I just want to urge all of you to continue supporting AHA by volunteering, by donating. And again, thank you so much for this honor. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much. I'm told that there is a question and answer period, and I'll be very happy to answer anybody's questions about how to make more money or donate more money. Yes.
Thanks so much for your presentation, and congratulations on your well-deserved award.
Thank you.
What do you want to hear from someone who's pitching you for a donation? Obviously, it's got to be sold to you. It's got to be something you care about, the basics. Let's dispense with those. What kind of impact do you need to have in that conversation?
You know, I do get pitched a lot of ideas from a variety of people in this organization. And the first thing I say to myself, number one, does this idea fit my goal for how I want to see this movement grow? Or is this some personal project of someone that gratifies their ego but doesn't move this movement forward? So that's the first thing. Does it fit my goals? Number two, who is the person that's pitching me? Do they have credibility? Are they able to make this program work? Because all these programs are totally dependent on the leadership. And is this person that's talking to me a leader that can make it happen? And then, you know, how much money is involved? When are we going to see the results? And how are we going to get feedback intermittently to make sure those results are on target? So those are basically the three things I look at. Yes?
Yes, I had a question that has always been on my mind, not always, but the last few years. And I am on the board of AHA, and I should probably know the answer to this, but I'm going to ask you anyway. There's the Secular Coalition for America, and there's the United Coalition of Reason. I have, and maybe some other people, have been a little confused about the difference between the two organizations, and is there an overlap, and do you cooperate with each other, or are you totally separate?
Thank you. Number one, the organizations are totally different. The Secular Coalition of America is an umbrella organization that encompasses all other organizations. So United Corps just is one of those many organizations under the SCA umbrella, just like AHA is a member, AA is a member, Freedom from Religion Foundation is a member. So that's the national umbrella organization that's mission is to lobby nationally with legislators to get this movement have more recognition from the national level, senators and representatives. United Corps, on the other hand, is a purely local project that goes out to various cities. So pick any city, Philadelphia, Denver, Los Angeles. Each of these cities has a variety of different groups. It could be an AHA group, it could be an American atheist group, but they're not talking necessarily. We need to get them together. So we try, and the mission that Fred goes to teach them how to deal with the media. We will give them a billboard as an example, as an incentive to get them together. We'll do a number of support programs, but it's all done on a local level, having nothing to do with the national SEA, if that answers your question.
We have a question over here.
Over here. See. I have my sunglasses. Yeah.
Here.
Oh, yes, hi. Hi there.
Hi, I'm Don Wharton. I was supported the Reason Rally in 2012. I recall that the Park Service was projecting 50,000 to 60,000 people before the forecasts of rain were coming in, and even with that rain, it was the largest, most successful gathering of humanists, atheists, secularists in the history of the world. One of the most common questions that I get as a local organizer is, when are we going to have another Reason Rally? Is there anything we can do to support your thinking on that?
Let me tell you, I'm with you on that, 100%. And I think one of the prime movers, in my mind, of the Reason Rally was Dave Silverman of American Atheists, who couldn't, unfortunately, be here today. And I've said to him, Dave, when are we going to have another Reason Rally? That thing was fabulous and will even be bigger next time. And he said, and Roy, maybe you know the answer to this also, that 2016, for me it should be 2015 and start planning it now, but supposedly no later than 2016, and it will be bigger and better than ever. Yeah.
You know, the Catholics and the evangelicals and the Jews all have their colleges and universities. Why can't the free thought movement eventually think of establishing a free thought college or university, maybe taking over a campus that has been discontinued or renting space in an office building like some colleges do? But we should have a free thought college here in the United States, I think.
I agree with you. I totally agree with you. It would almost be an evolution from a camp quest to a larger, you know, more advanced situation, high school, college. And that's one of those big projects that, you know. There is a Humanist Institute. And where is that located?
Everywhere.
Okay. 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 I think it needs more advertising, a little more marketing, so that it's known, because it's a great idea. But I think the question here was a physical location where people could matriculate at and, you know, learn all of the facets of humanism, secularism, and the like. And I think that's a separate point, and we should definitely do something like that. I think we would all support that. Thank you. Yes?
I want to respond to the question about the Reason Rally. When? My job is to recruit a board that will put that together next time. David Silverman, who did this fabulous job in putting it together, decided that he had a day job. And if it's going to be bigger and better, which is his and everyone's intention, he needed to have some professional separate people doing it. So we're putting together a board. The intention is to have it bigger and better. The intention is to do it professionally. And whether it's next year or the following year or the following year, bigger and better is the way to do it. And as soon as possible that we can do it bigger and better. So I ask for your indulgence. I ask for a little patience. And then I ask for your extraordinary cooperation when we put it together.
I'm happy to volunteer for that, so please.
Yes. Hello, my name is Emil Volchek, coordinator of the Baltimore Coalition of Reason, and thank you for your support and the contributions, because we exist because of you. Would you consider a matching grant program so that you got us $5,000 to put up the billboards over M&T Bank Stadium back in 2009. If we wanted to do something like that, would you consider offering a one-for-one match? for a Kickstarter?
Yes, you should get me on the public stand like this to commit myself. The process for that type of program, which I'm sure is a valuable program, would have to go through Fred Edwards, who basically does it all, and he's the coordinator and evaluates the different programs and the program requests. So you should by all means ask him. And we have a budget. In fact, I just saw the budget for next year yesterday, and it's an expanded budget. And I don't know specifically about the Baltimore Coalition of Reason, but if there is some potential, you should ask Fred, and certainly would want to look at that.
So we have time for one more question.
Hi there. Hi. My name is Nicole Curvin, and I'm the organizer of the Pittsburgh Coalition of Reason, so thank you very much for starting United Corps. My concern is that everybody in the U.S., you know, atheist is a household word. Everyone knows what it means, but nobody really knows what humanist means. Are there any plans in the works for a humanist terminology awareness campaign? Because I think that is a way that we would get a lot of people who are out there sleeping silently, not knowing they're humanists, to become part of the movement.
You know,
and yeah. Their money. And their money. Get their money.
You know, I think that's a great question. We're, as a group, are known by so many different names. I alluded to that earlier. And the word humanist, I mean, you know, exactly what does that mean? I agree. It's slightly vague, and it's certainly not known. If you asked 10 people in the street, what's a humanist, I'm sure 8 of them would not give you an intelligent answer. And there's a man right here in the front, Roy Speckhart, American Humanist Association, who I think one of his projects should be to explain to the world more about what humanism means and how we can all identify ourselves, because we're all humanists here, even though we might not explain it all the same way. There should be some definition that's more publicly known and understood by everyone. So, and he said he will do it. He just said that. So he's committed. Well, I don't think there's any more questions. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Steve. To introduce the recipient of the 2014 Humanist Heroine Award, I'd like to welcome the president of the Humanist Society of New Mexico, an artist, author, and editor-in-chief of Amador Publishers. She also serves as co-chair of the American Humanist Association's Feminist Caucus, which since its founding in 1977 has worked toward the advancement of women's rights and equality between the sexes in all aspects of society, which if you're paying attention to the news at all, we need now more than ever. Please welcome Zelda Kaduskin.
Wow, thank you. Even though it makes me very nervous to look out across this vast sea of faces, and I won't even dare to look over there where I'm giant on the screens. Whew. It is a special perk of being co-chair of the AHA Feminist Caucus to explore the work of feminists, to look into our nominees, and then to help select one and meet our awardee. Normally, my co-chair, Stephanie Downs Hughes, would be here with me, but she has given me this pleasure to hold the microphone all to myself. So thank you all very much. Our 2014 Humanist Heroine Award recipient, Jessica Valenti, has been a trailblazer for a new wave of feminists. She has given voice to the frustrating, infuriating, and ironic condition of young women who have been assured that our society has attained gender equality. Yet they continue to encounter sexist nonsense, if not genuinely dangerous prejudice, at every turn. While resistance to the feminist movement, unfortunately, has not abated much over the past few decades, if anything, it has taken on new dimensions across the internet. The feminist movement itself has progressed substantially. Our 21st century feminists are no longer knocking on the doors of power to demand their seat at the table. They are at the table. And they have brought their friends. Also their cameras, recorders, tablets, and I dare say even pens and pads. They are taking names and calling out sexism in all its ingrained and extreme expressions. Jessica Valenti has been a leader in this movement, creating the online platform for young feminist voices, feministing.com, and contributing her astute and acerbic commentary on the challenges facing women today through her books, articles, videos, and public presentations. Jessica's articles have appeared in many prestigious publications, such as The Washington Post, The Nation, The American Prospect, Ms. Magazine, and Salon, to name a few. She is the recipient of a Choice USA Generation Award and the 2011 Hillman Journalism Prize for her work with Feministing. As a widely sought-after speaker, Jessica gives speeches across the country and abroad, and is a frequent media commentator who has appeared on The Colbert Report, CNN, MSNBC, PBS, The Today Show, and others. Jessica holds a master's degree in women's and gender studies from Rutgers University and has been called one of the top 100 inspiring women in the world by The Guardian, for which she now writes regularly. She is the author of 4 books on feminism, politics, and culture, and editor of the anthology Yes Means Yes, Visions of Female Sexual Power and a World Without Rape, which was named one of Publisher Weekly's top 100 books of 2009. Her latest book is Why Have Kids? A New Mom Explores the Truth About Parenting and Happiness. Well, you can see Layla down here. That's why we have kids. Supergirl. This is how I came to know Jessica's work. She came to Santa Fe, New Mexico to help us lobby for pro-choice legislation and show her film, The Purity Myth. This was an event that was coordinated by Religious Coalition for Reproductive Choice, NOW, and other women's groups, which our humanist society was pleased to be a part of. So I was totally wowed by both the video, which comes from her book called The Purity Myth, and by Jessica herself as she addressed the crowd. Let's take a look at the trailer from The Purity Myth.
I am living my life the way that I think should be lived, and that's staying pure, so.
So you really believe in no sex before marriage?
No, I don't at all.
Traditional ideas about purity are suddenly everywhere.
We've so over-sexualized our society. We're robbing these kids of their innocence.
And it's breathing new life into a very old idea.
And so I want to talk to you today about pursuing the mission of purity.
Purity rings?
Purity, yes.
Purity, okay, let's talk about that.
Yes, I am a virgin. I just want to wait for that special someone.
Women are still led to believe that our moral compass lies somewhere between our legs, literally. Each year, thousands of purity balls where young girls pledge their virginity to their fathers are held across almost every state in the country.
I just want to say thank you for making this event, you know, the father-daughter purity ball, a lifestyle and an everyday thing.
Politicians increasingly extol the virtues of abstinence and virginity.
We want to see kids wait before they start having babies and sex.
And all told, American taxpayers shell out about $50 million a year on abstinence-only education in our schools, almost $500 million since 1996.
There is no such thing as safe sex.
This girl's gonna end up sterile or dead.
But the abstinence-only movement has never been about science, public health, or concern for young people.
The abstinence-only programs had no impact on whether or not participants abstained from sex.
They feel that they're remaining abstinent, not having vaginal intercourse, and they're seeking other ways of having sex.
So here's the biggest question of all. What is it about virginity that's so politically useful to the conservative movement?
It is pressed that a man marry a virgin. Young man, if you're dating a woman who boasts of being a feminist, who uses every four-letter word in the Marine Corps manual, who wants no children, who wants to drag you around like a dog on the end of a rope, run!
What the virginity movement really wants from women is submissiveness, and they've been prescribing a return to traditional gender roles as the cure.
The woman's deepest fulfillment is in motherhood.
And I think, too, that you underestimate the pride that women take in domesticity.
And if you listen closely, a pretty clear theme emerges.
Now, feminism is what I oppose, and feminism has led women astray.
Feminism is sexism.
Feminism is the fraud of the century.
Virginity movement extremists may sound ridiculous, but the results of their politics could not be more real.
Planned Parenthood does 330,000, more than 300,000 abortions each and every year. It is child abuse.
And I shall be looking for ways to unfund every other entity like them that promotes abortion or provides abortion. Planned Parenthood is invested in promiscuity.
This is a full-on virginity movement, actively working to roll back women's rights, using the purity myth to do it.
Jessica, you call it a myth, the purity myth.
What do you mean?
The purity myth is the lie that women's sexuality has some bearing on who we are and how good we are. Because really, I think that we all know that young women are so much more than whether or not they have sex.
Right.
We really should be teaching our daughters that their ability to be good people is based on their intelligence, their compassion, their kindness, not what they do with their bodies.
And the man needs to pursue the woman. You know, some people think, oh, that's just sexist. That's you know, all these antiquated ideas and gender stereotyping. Personally, I love gender stereotyping.
I think you can see why Jessica is our humanist heroine. Jessica, please join me on stage to receive our sincere commendation initiated by our AHA Feminist Caucus, the Humanist Heroine Award. Okay. Oh, they're going to stand up for you.
Don't do it again.
Oh, okay. I'm not quite. Oh, can we do that now? I have just a little bit more to go, so we might do that again. Jessica Valenti, through your creative and courageous application of new technology, the blog feministing.com, your journalistic integrity through the purity myth, book, and film, your genuine, passionate, and articulate expression of your own journey, and your many public appearances, you are a champion to feminists of all ages, as well as an effective advocate for our humanist ideals of equality, secularism, and freedom of self-expression. We are proud to recognize you as our AHA Humanist Heroine. Thank you so much. Jessica is going to speak for not too long, so that we have lots of time for questions and discussion. Okay? Thank you.
Thanks. Hello. Can we have another round of applause for Zelda and her great work with the Feminist Caucus, please? Pretty amazing. Get this microphone back a little. I'm from Queens, so I have a tendency to talk pretty loud without a microphone. It's really incredible to be here, thank you so much, to receive an award that so many of my own personal heroines, like Katha Pollitt and Loretta Ross, have also received, so I really am honored. But I did want to say that I'm accepting this award today on behalf of my number one feminist heroine, my daughter Layla, who's giving like the solidarity fist pump right there. If you ever need a person to deliver an impassioned speech about fairness and justice, I suggest that you start with a three-year-old who's been told that she can't have a cupcake at 8 a.m. She's sort of a debater in the making. So I'm glad that you got a chance to see a little bit of the purity myth, and I'm certainly happy to talk about the film more in Q&A. But what I really wanted to talk about today is what an extraordinary time it is to be a feminist. Because we're at this bizarre and fascinating moment in this country when there's both widespread cultural acceptance of feminism, but also a shockingly hostile disdain for women. And to see and experience these things simultaneously is frankly a mind fuck. Sorry. You thought the shoot the shit would be bad, but It's the best word that I'm a writer. It's the best word I could use to describe it. 10 years ago, when I started feministing.com, feminism was still largely considered the domain of man-hating Birkenstock owners, and today it's the preferred label of Beyoncé. 10 years ago, when a politician said something sexist, it barely made the local news. Now, when someone like Todd Akin says women can't get pregnant unless it's from a legitimate rape, the media doesn't just cover it, they're outraged along with us. Women's issues, once seen as special interest, helped elect our president with the largest gender gap in history, thanks to the votes of women of color. The last 10 years have seen tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands, of young women and men who have all started blogs, Tumblrs, Facebook pages, and organizations, all dedicated to gender, racial, and class justice. Feminism, in fact, has become so popular that even explicitly anti-feminist organizations like the Independent Women's Forum, a group that says the wage gap is a myth and protests against the vagina monologues, are starting to call themselves the real feminists, hoping to glean some of that cultural cachet. So suddenly, one of the most maligned movements in history is very much the zeitgeist. Yet. At the same time we're seeing this incredible progress, we continue to live in a country that is profoundly, terrifyingly misogynist. In the last year, we've seen 3 teenage girls who were raped commit suicide because of the awful shaming and harassment directed at them after they were attacked. We saw a defense attorney call an 11-year-old gang rape victim a spider, luring men into her web. That happened the same year that a 49-year-old teacher in Montana got only 30 days in jail for raping his 14-year-old student because the judge said she was, quote, older than her chronological age, and it, quote, wasn't this forcible beat-up rape. These are just the cases that we know about. Rape is at epidemic levels, and as one young woman once told me, somehow it is more shameful in this country to be raped than to be a rapist. Abortion remains legal, but only nominally. More abortion restrictions were enacted in the last 2 years than in the entire previous decade. 87% of counties have no abortion provider, and in states like Texas and Mississippi, women's health and rights are already suffering acutely, especially when it comes to those that are most in need. Rich women and upper middle class women will always be able to get the care that they need. Low income women already cannot. Despite the fact that we made birth control legal decades ago, there is somehow, bafflingly, an argument over whether or not contraception is part of women's health care or just a license for girls to get slutty. I think it can be both, and that's fine. I'm all right with that. 1 in 4 women in America will experience domestic violence, and 40% of female murder victims in America are killed by a current or former partner. So we already know that too many women are not safe in their homes. Now, thanks to a study that was released just last week, we also know that we're not safe in public either. The majority of American women have experienced harassment on the street, with nearly half being subject to aggressive street harassment like flashing or fondling. This study came out the same week that another study showed how prevalent online harassment of women is, a problem I could probably spend all day talking about or just open up my Gmail account to you, but we'll spare you the gory details of, at least until Q&A. In the last month alone, female students in one high school had their yearbook pictures photoshopped so they would appear more modest. A woman in Texas is suing after she was forced to give birth in solitary confinement and her child died. And a 16-year-old girl in Connecticut was stabbed to death by a classmate after she turned down his prom invitation because women turning down men's advances has become like a game of Russian roulette. And this was perhaps made most clear 2 weeks ago when a young man in Santa Barbara went on a rampage killing 6 people after writing a 140-page misogynist manifesto. And I want to just spend a minute talking about these shootings. Obviously, the tragedy in Santa Barbara was a combination of many things, including gun culture, racism, and mental health issues. But it was also about misogyny, and the reason we know this is because he told us it was. The shooter told us in this manifesto, in no uncertain terms, why he made the decision to commit mass murder. Because of women. Because it was unacceptable, he called it criminal, in fact, that women didn't want to sleep with him. Because he felt he was owed sex with women. Because women aren't people, but, quote, vicious, stupid, cruel animals, and, quote, a plague, and, quote, spoiled, heartless, wicked bitches who should not have any rights in a civilized society. He wrote he was waging a war on women and that he would destroy us. But despite having this clear motive outlined by the killer himself, when feminists pointed out that this was a sexist crime, we were accused of being craven opportunists, that this was a case of a lone madman, and arguing anything else was taking political advantage of an awful tragedy. But mental health problems and misogyny are not mutually exclusive. And the things this shooter said about women in his manifesto, those quotes that I read you, are not crazy by American standards. They're the norm. And as any feminist can tell you, they sound near identical to the emails that we get in our inboxes every day. So in the wake of this horrible crime, where a killer told us why he did it, I have to ask, if this isn't sexism, what is? If we're completely unwilling to name misogyny when it's explicit and violent and obvious, how will we ever stop it when it's hidden and insidious, which it so often is? Thankfully, I'm far from the only person who's asking this question. After the shooting, tens of thousands, and I think it might actually be closer to hundreds of thousands of women took to Twitter, sharing their experiences with violence, sexism, and harassment using the hashtag #YesAllWomen. Because while not all men are misogynist, all women have experienced misogyny. And we're sick of being told that it's in our heads, or that it's our fault, or maybe worst of all, that this is simply what life is like. Because it truly does not have to be what life is like. Every time we throw up our hands and expect that sexism is a given, that rape threats are just the cost of doing business as a female writer, or that sexual harassment is a natural male urge, or that it's perfectly normal for a young man to hate women for not sleeping with him, we're not just saying that we think violent sexism is inevitable. What we're really arguing is that we're unwilling to do anything about it. And I don't accept that. I don't accept that in a country of people who are at their core good and caring and just, that we can turn our heads away from the epidemic of hate on our doorstep. And I believe that part of the reason that we're seeing this surge of cultural acceptance of feminism is that we're nearing a critical mass of people who recognize that sexism is a national sickness, that the internet and the decades of feminism before the internet and the work being done by young people today has us very close to a tipping point for the movement. That said, it's very easy to adopt feminism as a label or identity when it's just about paying lip service to equality. It's much more difficult and much more needed to take action. We can't just talk about feminism when it's convenient or put on blinders to gender injustices when the conversations are hard or when they require us to examine our own complicity in oppression. Last week, I had the opportunity to interview a really wonderful writer and activist, Rebecca Solnit, who you should read if you don't already. And I asked her about this disconnect around the shootings, and I loved what she had to say, so I just wanted to share it with you. She told me, there are a lot of ideologies out there passionately devoted to not connecting dots. There are climate denialists who think that 97% of all the scientists on Earth are in conspiracy to spread lies and the weather is just fine. There are people who don't want to know that American foreign policy makes us, to say the least, a little unpopular in some places. And there are people who find that thinking about misogyny and violence against women is uncomfortable, and that they have a God-given or constitutional right to eternal comfortableness. So before we go to Q&A, I just want to encourage everyone in the room, especially in a room like this one where I know I'm with people who care about social justice and equality, to please make yourselves a little bit uncomfortable, to please connect the dots, and to make feminism a part of your everyday life and work. Not just because it's currently the popular thing to do or even because it's the right thing to do, but because in a moment like this of both change and crisis, it's the only thing that we can do. Thank you. Thank you.
We've got time for a few questions, so we have the roving mics. Just go up to Jennifer or Peter. Just raise your hand.
Oh, okay. All right. Over here on the on your right. Over here. How's it going?
Hello.
Hi, I'm Kyle. Quick question. I come from a very conservative background, mm-hmm. and I got the same kind of abstinence-only education whenever I was a kid, right?
Yeah.
And so, of course, it's not only for females that there's this emphasis, but there's also for males. Of course, there's a horrible hypocrisy and asymmetry in the kind of emphasis that females get versus males. But it's the kind of things that were, you know, told to me or and told to my friends and that kind of stuff, mm-hmm. like our motivation for being abstinent, was that, like, if you just wait, once you get married, it's a sexual utopia.
Right.
Right? and there was a lot of, like, you know, the kind of vision is like, that the woman in the relationship would do whatever you wanted. And right? And
gross.
And it's, yeah, right. So my question is, clearly that has a negative effect on men. It also clearly has a negative effect on women too, right? The mm-hmm. attitude and what we were told to expect. So I guess my question is twofold. One, have you dealt with that anywhere in your works? Uh-huh. And secondly, do you know of anyone who has approached like what you're approaching on the feminist end from the male end? Is there some other author that I might look up to
sure.
do to look at that?
I'll answer that last question first. And I think Jackson Katz is a really great male feminist who does a lot of work on this, who you might find useful. But it really is interesting. When I was doing this book and this film, this is not just about women. This is about creating a really toxic vision of masculinity for young men in this country. But that is very much about ownership of female sexuality, right? So like the purity balls that you saw, the girls like pledge their virginity to their dads and blah, 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 blah. When people started asking why aren't there mother-son purity balls, they created something called integrity balls. But instead of the sons pledging their virginity to their mothers, because that would be ridiculous, obviously, the sons pledged to be abstinent so that they wouldn't sully someone's daughter or future wife. So, right, so it's still very much about female sexuality. And I also think that like we have to talk about how insulting it is to men. Like, abstinence-only education, as you said, really sends this message that like men are sexual animals, that they can't control themselves, that all they want is sex. And I think that's a really limiting and damaging view for young men, especially when they're getting all of these sort of pop culture messages that support that as well. Definitely I would look to Jackson Katz for some of that. And I certainly address it in my books as well. Thank you. KATZ.
Hi.
Hi.
As a young feminist in a very conservative area, I live in southern Alabama, mm-hmm. A lot of other girls really have a negative opinion towards feminism. And when I say, oh, yeah, I'm a feminist, they're like, really? I've had someone say, oh, no, don't. I said, oh, well, it's too late. But I would love to know how the best way would be to tell these girls that feminism really is beneficial for them and is the only thing they can do, because so many of them don't see it and don't believe it and hate it.
Yeah. Well, I want to say that I think that that's a survival technique in patriarchy, right? To be like, oh, no, feminism, I'm not one of those. Because somehow if you separate yourself from feminists or other people, then it means that you're safe, right? Like that sort of gives you this veneer of safety. In terms of how to talk to people, this is probably a question that I get asked most often, especially on college campuses. And I would say, you know, try to meet people where they're at. I don't think it needs to be you saying to someone like, of course you're a feminist, what do you mean? Don't be ridiculous, which is sort of, you know, hard not to say, and you, because you want to throttle people. But you know, I think it could be as simple as, like, if they like a particular movie, there's a million blogs dedicated to feminist analysis of that movie, I assure you. You know, send them a blog post, be like, I thought you might be interested in this. Like, send them a speech, send them a GIF. You know, like, there's a million different pieces of media, I think, that can help you meet a person where they're at. And I also think what I've found to be really effective is to ask questions. Try to not get too defensive. I think feminists are so used to being attacked that we go on the defensive very quickly. You know, say, oh, really? You think that feminism is blah, blah, blah. Like, why do you think that? Where did you hear that? Let them talk and ask them questions about their lives. And I think you'll start to find sort of entry points for that conversation.
Question over here.
Hi.
Hello.
One of the frustrations I've had as an atheist activist mm-hmm. is that I have seen many of the things that, you know, Rush Limbaugh has said in your clips before. I have seen atheist activists and prominent atheists say very similar things. And if anybody doubts that, try posing as a female online sometime in an atheist bulletin board.
Yeah.
It's very instructive. do you have any... and depressing. Do you have any recommendations specific to the atheist or humanist community? Because I think there are some very serious issues in our own community about that.
Well, thank you for that question. I think it's a really important one. I mean, I think just to start by saying that, and you know, and saying that as often as you can, and in many, you know, as many places as you can, that this is an issue. Because I think, you know, this happens with a lot of progressive communities where it's like, not us. This is not our problem. Yes, it's our problem. It's all of our problem. You can see it in online forums. You can see it, you know, in conferences where all the panelists are white men. You know, you can see it happen in a million different iterations. There's a great blog, I imagine a lot of you know, Skeptics. And they're fantastic, and they certainly take on this issue quite a lot. So I would recommend, like, hitting them up, looking at their archives. I'm sure they've written about it, like, in a million different ways, better than I could say it in the 2 minutes that I have to answer your question. Thank you, though. This is a great question.
Hi, Jessica. I just first want to thank you for all the work you do.
Thank you.
I've read most of your books, and they've really helped me in my journey of becoming a male feminist.
Awesome.
And it's really been a really great experience to learn from you. So I wanted to ask you a question on a project I'm working on currently.
Sure.
So I feel like something that I've really come across is a lot of problems with feminism and men is sort of that these toxic masculine ideals kind of prevent men from becoming much more feminist.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm trying to get this project to work with professional sports organizations
yeah.
that are very toxic in their masculine ideals. And I'm working with some people at the Good Men Project mm-hmm. and a local sexual trauma center I work with. And we're very much at the beginning stages, but I was wondering what advice you would have for approaching that sort of community. So people that necessarily haven't engaged in a lot of self-reflection, but
right.
are very much on the end of the spectrum. I want to really work with those people because I feel like that's a good demographic to pursue, but I'm not really sure the best way to do that.
I think that's a really difficult question. Have you ever seen Byron Hurt's work? He's a he's a filmmaker. He did a movie called Beats and Rhymes Beyond Hip Hop, Beyond Hip Hop Beats and Rhymes, I think it is. And he's a former football player who works on feminist issues and goes is doing exactly the work that you're talking about doing. In terms of like how to reel them in when it's difficult because they're so invested in that bravado, and they're so in, there's, you know what I mean? Like when you're raised to think that this is what it means to be a man, I think that that's a really difficult shell to take off. That said, I think if you have men who go into places like this and are asking questions and are asking men to talk about their lives, talk about their stories, show films by Jackson Katz as, you know, a starting point for a conversation, or Byron Hurt's film as a starting point for a conversation. A friend of mine did something interesting when she was teaching a mostly male class of sort of, you know, like macho sports dudes, an intro to feminism class, and she said, like, next week I want you to all do something that like disrupts gender in some way, that makes you uncomfortable, right? And so for one guy, it meant wearing a pink shirt, right? And that sounds so like, okay, good job, fella, but like, for him, and he came back and he talked about that experience, for him, like, wearing a pink shirt was a really big deal, right? And it was a really difficult thing for him to do. So I think almost having sort of exercises or things like that that leave things open for men to decide, like, what their comfort level and level of engagement will be is helpful. I hope that that's helpful.
It was. Thank you.
Sure. And good luck. It sounds like a great project.
Good afternoon, Jessica. My name's Cy Chadley from the Humanist Fellowship of San Diego. There are more than 50% of women on the electorate roll in the United States, yet there are consistently less than 20% of women in Congress. Mm-hmm. What can be done to get more women, preferably humanist women, of course, into Congress?
We need to get more women to run for office, I think, is part of the problem. I think that, unfortunately, a lot of women have bought into the idea that you need to know a lot to run for office. you ask a man and, like, people at the White House Project and organizations who do work like this, you know, it's like if you ask a young man, like, do you think that you're qualified to be on city council or to run, they're like, absolutely, yes, of course I am. What a ridiculous question. But if you ask a woman the same thing, they'll be like, I don't know, I've only ever, like, done this, and maybe, that, you know, like, we downplay our achievements in a way that is not helpful. And of course that's not, you know, that's an individual problem, but it's an individual problem caused by systemic issues. So I think if we can, like, start teaching girls younger to own how smart they are, first of all, and to throw themselves into projects even if they don't feel fully prepared, and to run for office, that will start to make a bit of a dent, I hope.
Yes, hello. I apologize if this question is a bit too circumlocutious, so stop me if I go on too long. I wanted to ask you about the shootings in Santa Barbara. Uh-huh. I've been thinking about it a lot recently. There's been so much discussion. It's been so hard to avoid seeing people talking about it.
Yeah.
And I think to a certain degree we have to attribute the problems to a lack of empathy, that these guys who get sucked into men's rights or whatever else it's called, they even if they're ostensibly skeptical and they think they would change their mind in response to evidence, because they don't have empathy, they can't see the evidence.
Mm-hmm.
There was a blog post from Miriam Mogilevsky recently where she was talking about how men basically have to see violence against women firsthand before they're willing to believe the accounts that they're getting. I think this is a real problem, and I'd like to know if there's any way we can sort of teach empathy and get people to be more willing to listen,
right,
and acknowledge that these things are happening and we need to do something about it.
You know, I think what's difficult about having empathy towards women is that it's difficult to have empathy towards people that you're taught are not really people, but objects. And, you know, I do wonder about this idea of men only recognize violence against women when they see it, and I would argue that even then, they don't believe it. You know, we had the case in Steubenville, Ohio, of, you know, that rape case, where one of the witnesses, a young man, literally walked in on the assault and did nothing. And when he was asked, why did you do nothing, he said, well, I didn't know that was rape. Earlier in the evening, he had taken keys away from a drunk friend. So at some point in his life, he had gotten the message that it's not okay to let a friend drive drunk. But he literally did not understand that penetrating an unconscious woman was rape, because he thought of rape as violent and forcible. So I think that we have, like, a fundamental illiteracy around what violence against women is and looks like, and what sexual consent is and what that looks like. So I think that we could start there. And I think in terms of the lack of empathy, you know, the other problem is I didn't used to worry about the men's rights groups so much like 5 years ago, because they were sort of like an older disgruntled guys like talking to themselves, right? But now a lot of their readers are younger men, and they're providing this narrative of hate to younger men who are already like are maybe a little socially awkward, maybe can't get girls, maybe feel a little bit sad or insecure about themselves or their lives, and they're being given this narrative that says, it's not you, it's women's fault, right? And that's a really seductive narrative to a teenager who has not been taught anything else and who lives in a culture that supports that message largely. So I think it's going to take a lot of different things on both a cultural and a micro level.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Marisa Torres Langseth from HAPI. I think everybody knows now what HAPI is. It's the Humanists Alliance Philippines International. Anyway, I'm from the Philippines, where misogyny is quite normal. Mm-hmm. I've had experiences galore, so don't ask about it, even from a clergy. And I went to Saudi Arabia, to the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, to work, where women are treated like secondary citizens. Mm-hmm. So I was a secondary citizen in the Philippines. I was also a secondary citizen in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. When I came to the USA in 1990, it looks like I was also a secondary citizen. So, you know, to make myself feel better, I took a course. It's called How to Be a Better Bitch. In New York City, this is true. This is really true, because it's like I am always friendly and always entertaining men, and these men thought that I was flirting with them.
Right.
I don't flirt, I'm just friendly.
Right.
I don't understand that even in the USA this is happening. Why? It should only happen in the Philippines, in the third world countries, in Riyadh or in KSA or in the Islamic countries. Why is it happening here?
Right.
Why, really?
That's my question. I wish I had an answer to that question. I mean, I think what's really sad is that we do see a lot of, and I hear this a lot, you know, like, how dare you talk about sexism in America when women across the globe are being, you know, stoned or you know, systematically raped or oppressed in other ways, as if fighting against oppression is a zero-sum game and you can only do it sort of one country at a time or care about it in one place at a time. So yes, it is certainly alive and well, misogyny alive and well in America. I think it's embedded into how we were founded and who we are. I think we like to sort of see the progress that we've made and pat ourselves on the shoulder, and that gives us license to ignore the really clear misogyny and sexism that exists. And I also think it's because the way our society functions, and certainly capitalism functions, relies on female subservience and, you know, and women staying at home and men being the breadwinners, and sort of traditional ideas about families and masculinity and femininity support the current structure. So I think it's a really hard thing to unpack. And how both sad and great that you took a course on how to be a better bitch. It's sort of incredible to me that, you know, in order to exist in the world, like, we need to take courses so that we won't, or hopefully won't, be harassed. But I imagine now that you're a little bit more bitchy, you probably get harassed for being bitchy. I know that's certainly the case for me.
This is our last question.
Hi, I'm new to the humanist movement, and my oldest girls received purity rings. And this week, my daughter turned 14, and I went, I don't know what to do to celebrate this becoming a woman, because I'm not going to do a purity ring. Do you have any recommendations for something to celebrate that she's a woman? Although I'm thinking the last speaker, maybe I should sign her up for How to Be a Better Bitch. But, you know, what, coming from that was so much a part of my raising my children. By the way, it didn't work. But any recommendations? How do I foster that? And is there anything you can suggest that would be just to really celebrate who she is as a person?
Right. That's a great question. I haven't thought about that. You know, my mom was a big hippie, and when I got my period, she definitely wanted to do like a menses party. And I was not feeling that at all. I was like humiliated and not. So stay away from the period parties, I guess, would be my first piece of advice. I think, why don't you ask her, right? You know, I think like we can ask our daughters and our sons, like, when did you feel like a man? What makes you feel like a woman? What made you feel like an adult? And how can we celebrate that? And I think sort of encouraging that sort of self-reflection and critical thinking in our kids is the best way to go. Thanks. And that was the last question, right? Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Jessica. That concludes our luncheon. Sessions start at 3 p.m. in either Independence or Freedom. The toughest decision you'll have to make is which session you want to go to, but you can go back and forth. Have a great afternoon, everyone.